Welcome back. Today we are going to talk about dielectric resonators. We have previously studied transmission line resonator and closed cavity resonators. And in closed cavity resonators, we have studied rectangular cavity resonator and cylindrical cavity resonator. Now we are going to study another type of resonator, which is not closed. It can be considered as open resonator. It is composed of a dielectric sample, like this sample. It can be cylindrical shape, like this shape, or it can be rectangular, or can be triangular prism, or any other shapes. And it is composed mainly from a dielectric material. This is what is called dielectric resonator. Actually, dielectric resonator is the opposite to the closed cavity resonator composed of closed cavity of perfect electric conductor material. In dielectric resonators, we are usually use material with low loss and high dielectric constant. So, usually, in dielectric resonators, the dielectric is usually greater than 20. And it is preferred to use material with loss tangent much smaller than 1 of 1,000, 0.0001. So, dielectric resonator typically uses material with low loss and high dielectric constant, ensuring that most of the field will be contained within dielectric. Because actually, as we are going to increase the dielectric constant, the total field will be confined inside the dielectric material. But, because this dielectric resonator is usually open, there are some fringing fields. And these fringing fields will introduce some radiation. That's what we are seeing. However, there is some field fringing or leakage from the sides and the ends of the dielectric resonator. This field fringing and leakage introduce small radiation losses. And effectively, the radiated field correspond to losses or correspond to power dissipated from the resonator. So, this radiation losses is added to the dielectric losses and reduces the quality factor of the resonator. So, the leakage due to the radiation will introduce small radiation loss, and this small radiation loss will reduce the quality factor of this resonator. As I said, the dielectric constant is in the range from 10 to 100. Materials with dielectric constant in the range from 10 to 100 are generally used as example for the materials for dielectric resonators are barium titanate and titanium dioxide. So these are some examples of dielectric resonators. And actually, there is a very important issue in the dielectric material of the resonator is the thermal expansion of the material. Because actually, the resonance depends on the dielectric constant of the material and the shape of the cavity. So if the shape of the cavity is varying with temperature, the resonant frequency will be varying too with temperature. In this case, it is preferred to use material with very small expansion coefficient with temperature. Dielectric resonator actually it doesn't include any conducting material. So conductor loss are absent in dielectric resonator. However, The dielectric losses usually increases with dielectric constant, because effectively, as the dielectric constant increases, usually the tan delta or log tangent is increased too. Okay. Although the dielectric resonator is pure dielectric material, we can tune the dielectric resonator by attaching or coupling any metallic bar to the dielectric resonator. So, by using adjustable metal blade above the resonator, the resonant frequency can be mechanically tuned. As an example of this, we can use a screw, metallic screw, which is not touching the dielectric resonator. But by reducing the distance between the metallic screw and the dielectric resonator, the resonant frequency of this dielectric resonator will be slightly tuned or slightly varied. The dielectric resonator, it can be considered in this example as a short lens of lens L of a dielectric waveguide open at both ends. Assuming that we have a cylindrical waveguide, cylindrical dielectric waveguide, and we have cut this cylindrical waveguide with two open ended in both sides. It should be noted that this actually the opposite to the closed cavity resonator. In the closed cavity resonator, we are talking about a hollow waveguide, and this hollow waveguide is cut and short circuited by perfect electric conducting plane in both sides. Now, in the dielectric resonator, it is a waveguide, it is an open waveguide resonator or open dielectric waveguide, and this open dielectric waveguide is cut at both ends by open circuit, not short circuit. The lowest order for the cylindrical dielectric waveguide is TE01 mode, and actually this is the dual for the closed hollow wave guide composed of conducting material. In the hollow wave guide, the dominant mode for circular metallic wave guide, it was TM01 mode. So, in the case of dielectric wave guide, the dominant mode is TE01 mode. In the case of metallic wave guide, the dominant mode is TM01 mode. This is assuming that we are talking about circular waveguide. So, the dominant or the lowest resonant frequency for the proposed dielectric resonator composed of a sample of cylindrical structure is TE01 delta mode. And effectively, the first mode will occur when the lens of this dielectric resonator is nearly lambda guide over 2, where lambda guide is the guided wavelength inside the cylindrical dielectric wave guide. So, the resonant lens for the TE01 delta mode is slightly less than lambda guide over 2, where lambda guide is the guide wavelength of the TE01 mode dielectric waveguide mode. And the symbol delta here corresponds to 2L over lambda guide. So for the first mode, TE011 mode, we are talking about a length corresponds to lambda guide over 2. The equivalent circuit for the resonator in this case looks like transmission line terminated by purely reactive loads at both ends. And actually, these reactive loads are quite close to open circuit loads, but it is not pure open circuit. Okay? This approximation is based on the assumption that magnetic wall boundary condition can be imposed at rho equals a. In the previous example for circular waveguide, circular metallic waveguide, the boundary condition is that we have perfect electric conductor at rho equals a. Now, in the case of cylindrical dielectric waveguide, actually the dielectric is interfaced with the air directly. So the question, what will be the situation of the fields just at the boundary between the dielectric and air? Effectively, because we are using very high dielectric constant epsilon r, the intrinsic impedance of the medium of the resonator or the dielectric waveguide is much less than the intrinsic impedance of the free space, because the intrinsic impedance is eta over square root epsilon r. So if epsilon r here is very large value, the intrinsic impedance of this dielectric medium is very small. In this case, the reflection coefficient from the dielectric medium to the free space, it would be eta naught minus eta over eta naught plus eta. Eta here is the intrinsic impedance of the wave inside the dielectric medium, which is eta naught over epsilon r. So this equation can be approximated as square root epsilon r minus 1 over square root epsilon r plus 1. And because the value of epsilon r is very large value, the reflection coefficient in this case is nearly equals unity or 1. Effectively, the reflection coefficient 1 corresponds to perfect magnetic conductor. In the case of perfect magnetic conductor, the reflection coefficient is nearly 1. So it means that the boundary of the high dielectric constant of this resonator, it can be approximated as a perfect magnetic conductor surface. So the assumption that there is a magnetic wall boundary or perfect magnetic conductor condition can be imposed at rho equals a. And as I mentioned, this approximation is based on the fact that the reflection coefficient of wave in high dielectric constant region incident from the dielectric to air on air region approach 2 plus 1. And the value of the reflection coefficient of 1 is actually the reflection coefficient from perfect magnetic conductor. On the other hand, the reflection coefficient from perfect electric conductor is minus 1. Okay, so we are going to assume that this circular waveguide structure is covered with a perfect magnetic boundary from the curved boundary or from the curved surface. This reflection coefficient gamma, which is 1, this reflection coefficient is the same as that obtained at an ideal magnetic wall boundary condition or imperfect open set. This assumption will simplify for us the analysis of the cylindrical dielectric waveguide. In the cylindrical dielectric waveguide, for the transverse electric mode, it is required to solve the wave equation for the longitudinal HZ field component. Because transverse electric, it means that the electric field lies only in the transverse plane. We have only longitudinal component of magnetic field. So the longitudinal component is HZ. By solving HZ, we can obtain the transverse field component E rho, E phi, H rho, and H phi. Okay? This wave equation for the case of a dielectric waveguide of epsilon r is nabla squared plus k squared hz, where k is the square root epsilon r k. We are going to assume that the dielectric resonator is simply a waveguide section of length L with epsilon r and attached to another or two waveguide sections of the same radius but with dielectric constant epsilon r equals 1. This means that we have a waveguide section of epsilon naught connected to another wave section of epsilon naught multiplied by epsilon r connected to a third waveguide section of epsilon naught. This is a simple approximation for the analysis of this dielectric resonator. And it will be assumed that the field inside the section with epsilon r has a real propagation constant j beta, or real propagation constant j beta, while it is attenuating in both sides of the air. So the wave would be propagating as e to the power minus alpha z outside the dielectric resonator. So it is required to solve the fields or the longitudinal field component in both inside the dielectric resonator and outside the dielectric resonator. So in the case of inside the dielectric resonator, we are going to use k as epsilon r, square root epsilon r k naught, where the magnitude of z is less than or equal L over 2. Or in other words, from z equal minus L over 2 to L over 2. On the other hand, the value of k would be the free space wave number k naught for the magnitude of z greater than L over 2, or in other words, for z greater than L over 2, or z minus or z less than minus L over 2 if z is negative. Okay? By solving this wave equation Hz, we can obtain the transverse field component. And because we are interested in the mode TE 0-1 mode, this means that the dependence on the azimuth direction or in phi direction will be varying with zero, or in other words, will be constant. So the derivative with respect to phi would be zero. If the derivative with respect to phi is zero, this means that e rho would be zero, and h phi it would be zero. So the transverse field component available in this case is only or are only e phi, which is j omega mu over k c squared multiplied by the derivative of hz with respect to rho, and h rho, which would equal minus j beta over k c squared multiplied by the derivative of hz with respect to rho. On the other hand, e rho would be 0 and h phi would be 0 because they are proportional to the derivative of hz with respect to phi, and effectively hz would be constant because we are talking about the mode TE 0, one mode. Alright? And beta, it can be determined in terms of the cutoff wave number as k cutoff squared equals k squared minus beta squared. If I am inside the dielectric constant, k it would be square root epsilon r k naught. If I am in the free space, k it would be k naught. Alright? Solving this wave equation for hz, The general solution, it would be Bessel function. We have two types of Bessel function, Bessel function of first kind and Bessel function of second kind. And because the field should be finite at rho equals zero, we are going to ignore the Bessel function of second kind, because Bessel function of second kind has infinity at rho equals zero. So the solution of the wave equation says that the magnitude of Hz or Hz would equal magnitude H naught multiplied by the Bessel function of first kind, and because we are talking about order zero, it would be J zero. And the argument here, it would be Kc multiplied by rho, multiplied by the propagation constant e to the power j beta z, plus or minus, plus for forward propagating and minus for backward propagating. And actually, inside the resonator, we have both of them. We have forward propagating wave and backward propagating wave, and both of them at the resonance are equal. So we have a forward component and backward component in this case, right? In this case, the value of the cutoff wave number Kc, it would be B01 over A, where B01 is the first zero, or is the first zero for the Bessel function J0. So B01 is the first zero of the Bessel function of first kind of order 0. And the value of B01 is 2.405. So, the fields inside the dielectric waveguide section can be obtained as E phi is J omega mu naught over Kc multiplied by the derivative of Hz with respect to rho is H naught J dash 0 of Kc rho. Here this was Kc squared, so we have Kc and Kc squared, so this was only Kc here, multiplied by e to the power minus, plus or minus J beta Z. On the other hand, H rho would be minus or plus J beta H naught over Kc, J naught H, J naught dash, which is the first derivative of the Bessel function of first kind of zero order, of Kc rho multiplied by e to the power plus or minus J beta Z. It should be noted here that because this is open circuit, the two ends of the dielectric resonator are open circuit, so both the forward propagating electric field and backward propagating electric field have the same sign. On the other hand, because we are going to approximate the surface of the dielectric resonator by perfect magnetic conductor, the tangential magnetic field, the forward propagating and the reflected propagating would be of opposite signs, such that the total tangential magnetic field here should be nearly zero. Okay? This will be reflected in what? In saying or approximating the total field inside the dielectric resonator here, we will have e to the power j beta z plus e to the power minus j beta z, which will be equivalent cosine beta z. But in the case of the magnetic field, H rho, here it would be minus e to the power plus j beta z plus e to the power minus j beta z, which will correspond to sine beta z. Okay? So the magnetic field, the total magnetic field inside the dielectric resonator, the total transverse magnetic field, the total transverse magnetic field inside the dielectric resonator will be proportional to sine beta z. But the total transverse electric field inside the dielectric resonator will be proportional to cosine beta z. In a similar way, the total longitudinal magnetic field would be proportional to cosine beta z. Okay? Alright. Now we have already solved the problem inside the dielectric material. The question now, what will be the situation in the air or in the other part? In the air part, we are going to assume that the field is attenuating or non-propagating. So, the propagation constant will be purely imaginary and it would be alpha. It will not be beta. And the value of alpha in this case, it would be the square root of k c squared minus k naught squared. It should be noted, beta is the square root of k squared minus k c squared. But alpha is the opposite, is the square root of k c squared minus k naught squared. Alright? So, in the dielectric region, where the magnitude of z is less than L over 2, the propagation constant would be real and it would be beta equals square root epsilon r k naught squared minus kc squared, where kc here is b 01 over a, which we have obtained from solving the wave equation of hz inside the circular dielectric waveguide. And the wave impedance inside the dielectric waveguide would be ZD, Z dielectric, which will be the transverse field component, the transverse electric field component, E phi, over the transverse magnetic field component, H rho, which is omega naught, omega mu naught over B. On the other hand, outside the dielectric medium, the propagation constant will be pure imaginary and it will be, instead of propagation, it will be attenuation. So instead beta, it would be alpha, and it would be square root, instead of k squared minus kc squared, it would be square root kc squared minus k naught squared. And effectively, alpha as it is a real part, but if we are talking about square root k naught squared minus k c squared, it would be imaginary minus g alpha. So, alpha equals square root k c squared minus k naught squared, and k c squared, which we have already obtained from the solution of the dielectric wave guide resonator. Because effectively, the transverse propagation constant at the boundary inside the dielectric should be the same outside the dielectric. So, it would be the same, B01 over A squared minus K naught squared. And the wave impedance in the air, ZA, it would be, because actually, this is the imaginary attenuation, so it would be minus G alpha here. It would be, instead of beta, it would be omega naught, omega mu naught over minus g alpha. So we can replace minus g alpha in the denominator by plus g in the numerator. So the wave impedance at the air would be pure imaginary in this case and equals g omega mu naught over the value of alpha. Now we have beta and we have alpha. We have the fields inside the dielectric resonator and the fields outside the dielectric resonator. By applying the boundary conditions such that the tangential electric field at the top interface just in air should equal the tangential electric field at the top interface just in the dielectric medium, and similarly in the lower face, we say that the tangential fields E phi equals the amplitude A multiplied by G naught dash, which is the first derivative of the Bessel function of first kind of zero order, of Kc rho multiplied by cosine beta z. Cosine beta z, as I mentioned, is the magnitude of the forward plus the reflected field. And the transverse magnetic field, H rho, is minus Ga over Zd, which is the relation between E phi and H rho, is the wave impedance inside the dielectric. J naught dash K zero multiplied by sine beta Z. And as I explained before, here we have a forward propagating wave and backward propagating wave, and they are in opposite sign in the case of the transverse magnetic field. Because they are in the opposite sign, the summation of them is proportional to sine beta Z or J sine beta Z. Okay? In a similar way, the transverse field components outside the dielectric resonator would be the magnitude B multiplied by J naught dash K zero multiplied by e to the power minus alpha multiplied by the magnitude of Z. If Z is positive, it would be e to the power minus alpha Z. If Z is negative, it would be e to the power plus alpha Z. Right? On the other hand, the transverse magnetic field outside the dielectric resonator would be plus or minus B over the wave impedance at air, ZA, multiplied by J naught dash K zero multiplied by e to the power minus alpha multiplied by the magnitude of Z. It should be noted here that the transverse field component outside the resonator is composed of either attenuating in positive Z or attenuating in negative Z, because it is not composed of forward and backward. It is only either forward attenuating or backward attenuating. Right? A and B are unknown amplitudes in this case, corresponds to the amplitude of the field outside the resonator and the field inside the resonator. A corresponds to the fields inside the resonator, and B corresponds to the fields outside the resonator. Right? Now, by applying the boundary condition at the top face, that the tangential transverse electric field inside the dielectric medium equals the tangential transverse electric field just outside the dielectric medium. So, at the value of Z equals A, A multiplied by J naught dash K zero cosine beta A, sorry, beta L over 2, beta L over 2, it would equal B multiplied by J naught dash K zero multiplied by E to the power minus alpha L over 2. Here is the magnitude of the tangential E phi at Z equals L over, at Z equals L over 2. And here is the magnitude of E phi outside at Z equals L over 2. It can be noted that this J naught dash K zero will be eliminated with this one. The remaining part, it would be A cosine beta L over 2 would equals B multiplied by E to the power minus alpha L over 2. This by applying the boundary condition for the tangential electric field. In a similar way, we can apply the boundary condition for the tangential magnetic field. For the case of the tangential magnetic field at Z equals L over 2, we will have H rho would be minus Ja over Zd J naught dash K zero sine beta L over 2 should equal plus B over Za multiplied by J naught dash K zero e to the power minus alpha L over 2. By eliminating J naught dash with J naught dash, we can obtain that minus GA over ZD sine beta L over 2 would equal B over ZA multiplied by e to the power minus alpha multiplied by L over 2. Now, we have two equations. We can eliminate A and B to obtain the corresponding characteristic equation for this dielectric resonator. So, in this case, we are going to replace B by A multiplied by cosine beta L over 2 multiplied by e to the power alpha L over 2. We are going to replace B by A. And then A, this A would be eliminated with this A. E to the power plus alpha L over 2 will be eliminated with e to the power minus alpha L over 2. We can move this ZA to be the numerator here and this D to be the numerator in this here. So the characteristic equation, the obtained characteristic equation for this dielectric resonator in this case, according to the boundary condition, is minus JZA, which is the air wave impedance, multiplied by sine beta L over 2, equals ZD, the wave impedance inside the dielectric medium, multiplied by cosine beta L over 2. This is the characteristic impedance. And taking into consideration that ZA is J omega mu naught over alpha and ZD is omega mu naught over beta, so we can replace this ZA by J omega mu naught over alpha and this ZD by omega mu naught over beta. So the total equation now will be function of alpha and beta only. Here, sine beta L over 2 can be divided by cosine beta L over 2. We can obtain tan beta L over 2. Here we have minus J or plus J omega mu naught over alpha multiplied by minus J. This would minus J multiplied by J would be unity omega mu naught over alpha. Here, omega mu naught over beta. So we can omega mu naught will be eliminated with omega mu naught. Would be alpha over beta. So the final form for the characteristic equation for the dielectric resonator is simply tan beta L over 2 equals alpha over beta, where beta is the square root of epsilon r k naught minus kc square, which is square root of epsilon r k naught square multiplied by B01 over A square, where B01 is 2.408, which we have already mentioned before. And alpha is square root of KC squared minus K naught squared, which is square root of B, notice B01 over A squared minus K naught squared. Now, if you are looking at this equation is function of beta, alpha, and L. And actually, beta and alpha are functions of A, which are the parameters or the dimensions of the dielectric resonator. Here, A is the radius of the resonator, L is the length of the resonator, epsilon R is the dielectric constant of the resonator. What is the unknown here? The unknown is the value of K naught. And K naught, which satisfies this equation, corresponds to the free space wave number, which satisfies this characteristic equation. This free space wave number K naught is actually 2 by F over C. 2 by F over C. And F is a frequency. So 2 by is constant, C is constant. So the only parameter which we can obtain from this equation is the frequency. This frequency is actually the resonant frequency of this dielectric resonator. So the frequency which satisfies this characteristic equation corresponds to the resonant frequency of this dielectric resonator. That's what we are saying. The solution is approximate since it ignores the fringing field at the sides of the resonator and it yields accuracy only of order 10%. On the other hand, if you are interested in calculating the unloaded quality factor, it is simply the unloaded quality factor due to the dielectric loss, which we have already proved that in the case of any resonator, the dielectric loss is 1 over 10 delta. So the quality factor due to the dielectric loss is simply 1 over 10 delta. Alright, that's how we are solving the resonant frequency for a specific dielectric resonator. So, assuming that, I am saying that we have a dielectric resonator of a radius, say, 1 cm and length, for example, 0.5 cm and dielectric constant, say, 20. What is the resonant frequency of this dielectric resonator? We are going to apply this epsilon r is 20. This is the radius and this is the length. We are solving this equation until we find out the value of k naught which satisfies this equation. And from this k naught, we are saying that this k naught is 2 by f over c. We can obtain the frequency. As an example here, find the resonant frequency and approximate unloaded quality factor for the TE01 delta mode of a dielectric resonator made from titania. Titania has a dielectric constant epsilon r equals 95 and 10 delta equals 0.001. The resonator dimensions are the radius A is 0.413 centimeters and the value of L or the length of the resonator is 0.8255 centimeters. This means that it is required to solve the equation 10 beta L over 2, where L is this value, equals alpha over beta, where alpha is the square root B01, which is 2.405 over A, where A is 0.413. And should be this in centimeter, it should be multiplied by 10 to the power minus 2, minus k naught squared. And beta is square root epsilon r. Epsilon r here is 95, k naught squared, minus 2.405 over a. Once again, a is 0.413, multiplied by 10 to the power minus 2. And k naught is 2 by f over c. Actually, we are going to solve this equation to find out the value of k naught. Once we obtain k naught, we can obtain the frequency f. Okay? The question now, what is the range or the frequency range which we are going to solve for it or look for the root of this characteristic equation in this? This can actually be determined as the value of alpha and the value of beta must be real value. This means that the value of k naught or the minimum value of k naught, the minimum value of k naught is 2.405 over a. The minimum value of k naught means that, the maximum value of k naught is 2.405 over a. Means that k naught must be less than this value such that the value of alpha is real. Or, in other words, the value under the square root is positive. So, k naught must be less than or equal this value. On the other hand, this value 2.405 over A must be less than or equal epsilon r k naught squared. Or in other words, epsilon r k naught squared must be greater than or equal this value such that the value of beta would be pure rare. So, the lowest frequency or the minimum value of k naught, it can be obtained from this equation. So, the lowest frequency f1 is c multiplied by k naught over 2 pi c multiplied by k naught over 2 pi, and the minimum value of k here is 2.405 over a over epsilon r. 2.405 over a over square root epsilon r. This actually the minimum value of k naught, because the value of k naught is less than this value. This value would be less than this value, and this would be imaginary, and this is not allowed. So the value of k naught should be greater than 2.405 over a over square root epsilon r. In other words, the frequency should be greater than or equal this value. On the other hand, the value of k naught should be less than this value. So, the maximum frequency that can we obtain, it should be less than or equal c naught k naught over 2 pi, where k naught here is 2.405 over a. 2.405 over a. This is the maximum value of k naught. So, this is the minimum frequency and this maximum frequency. So, we are going to solve this equation for the range from frequency 2.853 to frequency 27.804. This is the allowable range for searching for the root of this characteristic equation. By searching for the root for this characteristic equation in this range, we find out that the first resonant frequency is at frequency around 3.152 GHz. Once again, we have determined the lowest frequency and the highest frequency which are allowed for searching for the root of this equation. Then we are going to search for a root inside this range. By searching for a root inside this range, the first root or the first resonant frequency is found to be at 3.152 GHz. Okay, so the root of the above equation gives a resonant frequency or the first resonant frequency at about 3.152 GHz. This is the resonant frequency of this resonance. On the other hand, the unloaded quality factor QD is 1 over 10 delta, and 10 delta here is 0.001, so the unloaded quality factor of this resonator is nearly 1000. Okay, this is what is meant by dielectric resonator.